Welcome everybody to Sustainable River Basin Management Module 4.2, Part 4. Now let's look into the conflict management approaches today. There's an increase as our conflicts evolve from a hidden, latent, small conflict grow along our conflict evolution pathway. There's an increase in probability that we will end up in a win-lose situation. There's one, the first step would be to avoid conflicts. But as said, they are inbuilt in our societies, so we can not in all of the cases avoid our conflicts and ignore. It will come to the point that we simply ignore the conflicts and end up in the same pathway as if the conflict would have been accepted loudly and be handled with. And on the other end, if no steps are taken in between, we will end up in hard or sharp violence. Now in between we have approaches, we have steps to deal with the conflict. We can use negotiation techniques, we can use mediation, we could move up to arbitration, and we could end up, when all of those have failed, with non-violent direct action, mass demonstrations, for instance, which still could lead to a de-escalation of the conflict and move back to another state where we can negotiate or avoid the conflict from escalating. Or if nothing of this is successful or handled with care, we will end up with the violent situation. Now, conflict handling can take in place in various steps. And one of the conflict handling mechanisms, probably known to all of you, is so-called litigation. That means that we take a case to the court. We have an issue, we know what our legal rights are, we have a legal system in place in our country, and we hand it over to our lawyer, or it may go to the court. Now, this works in many cases, but there are substantial limitations to it. They are very problematic for common resources such as water, which is a common, over which no party has a clearly superior legal claim. It is maybe a matter of having been to the place first and have claimed it first, but legally or otherwise, not a single party can actually claim the common resource as his or her own. And in such cases, the court will be very limited in its decision taking. The decisions are made by a judge based on law. This is again, if there is no law in place, then obviously no decision can be made. And it's also depending on an individual, the judge, depending on his or her level of approaching the case, the decision will be made and has to be accepted and acceptable by the parties, the conflicting parties. Not all of the issues can be brought to court if there is no legal provision for it, or if no legal rules were actually infringed. And this is very applicable to water resources and commons in general, that very often we cannot actually raise a specific legal rule and still there will be a conflict over the water resource, water scarcity, and the way water has been allocated. So parties may not have access to courts by a given legal rules. This is very often the case if there's a financial restriction or if parties are not have no legal access to the existing country courts or legal frames, may not be represented properly. Those parties could be legal or it could be individuals, could be communities, But it also could be something like the environment as such, which will be affected, or some wildlife maybe affected the fishery industry, and as such that fishery industry or the wildlife populations will not have access to the court. In such ways, the issue of claiming something cannot really be expressed in the appropriate way through the court system. The real differences remain usually unresolved due to overimportance given to procedural and legal issues. That's another aspect where many of the cases get stuck and or lost between the paper procedures and after all given up, or due to lack of resource, or the case has been completely lost because water is completely polluted, or the water may simply not be available anymore because waters have dried up. Now, this is not very satisfactory, and for that reason, there are other conflict handling mechanisms. And such a mechanism is the alternative dispute resolution, or ADR, usually in the literature. It's an alternative to the litigation. It is building on consensus. It is trying to bring all parties together to agree upon something. It aims at collective or win-win solutions. It usually works in a participatory approach to dispute settlements. It also has its sources very much in traditional legal systems and resonates very much traditional societies. And in many cases, dealing with commons are a very appropriate way to use. What are the tools of the alternative dispute resolution? One of them is negotiation. This means that there are meetings of parties without facilitation or without mediation. Those parties try to achieve a mutual agreeable outcome. This is usually at the very beginning, when people or parties are still able to come together to work on a common solution and on interest, have both sides a developed interest of finding a solution. In many cases, this is being used as a kind of negotiated rulemaking, especially in applicable in the case of industrial safety standards or the so-called white papers that we talked about earlier when we were dealing with water pollution. Those are negotiated rulemaking. This is stakeholders, groups of interests from industries or from communities, of rural communities, may come together, decide upon something, and then all follow exactly what they decided, what is good for them. The next level to this is called facilitation, and this means that there's an impartial person helping to define the conflicting issues and to design a dispute resolution process. So this means it's not about the solution itself. This is simply to identify the conflict evolution pathway, to understand what are the issues at hand, and then to come up with a process of how to deal with that conflict. The next level to this is called mediation, and this is a third level to this, which is being used usually when the situation has been reached to a point where parties are not willing to come together anymore. There's no trust to meet at a specific point or to provide information. And that is when a mutually accepted outside party is called in and called to oversee the conflict settling process. That person or group of persons guides the whole process and guides it to a mutually acceptable solution. So this is very carefully phrased also, because it is in the first place very hard to identify a group of people or a person, individual, who would be trustworthy and knowledgeable and acceptable by both of the conflicting parties. It must also be somebody who is able to stay outside, neutral in the process, and is able to drive the entire process of conflict settling, not just advising, but leading the process itself. And although we may balance the outcomes in different ways, and maybe from outside not say it's a win-win solution, after all, the objective is an acceptable solution. So what is acceptable and what is a win on one side and perceived as a win on the other side, this is what this mediator has to figure out and bring to the desk and table for the conflict resolution. This also includes the creation of a safe environment for information sharing and also to channel, to vent emotions. Usually the costs of such a mediator and the process are shared by the parties, but that is something that again has to be agreed upon before going into such a process. This can take years, it can take days, but usually it takes quite a long time to achieve a final acceptable outcome through such a process. And then we have arbitration, which is informal, faster than litigation, also usually not as time intensive and expensive. The process and outcome has to be defined prior to going into the arbitration, and those outcomes could be defined as binding, or they could as well be left open. This is a matter of agreeing and defining beforehand. The parties choose an arbitrator. It can be a panel of neutral experts, or again could be an elderly person that is respected by both sides, as knowledgeable about the case, the situation, and for that reason is trusted by both sides. And then there are hearings from each party, and finally an award will be made. This is the process for it. Now, this is when conflicts have occurred already, the handling mechanisms. And then there's a last one to that, which is conflict prevention, which builds on the consensus building. It's a stakeholder approach, and it also builds on the creation of so-called enabling environments. What such conflict prevention would include is to define problems rather than proposing solutions. It's also to find various alternatives and separate processes from the evaluation of the process itself. It also includes to agree on evaluation criteria and principles. This should not be jumped also. It should follow a certain logic and procedure. Only if this one can be achieved, the next can be achieved as well successfully. There should be a record keeping to avoid later misunderstandings. Those parties should agree on a process for the revision of agreements and a process of resolving any discrepancies. What we often see is that at some point under very tense conditions, accords came into being, and once those accords expire, there's no provision or mechanism in place of what to do after the accord has expired. Those things are part of process definition and should take place at beforehand, before signing such agreements. There should be agreement and follow up on the defined processes to achieve what was agreed upon. There should be a commitment created for the implementation, and the roles should be defined for the execution of agreed actions. Very often we see in such accords that just some technicians are mentioned to take responsibility for this and that, and this then at the end such institutions having such technicians are, do not exist, or that for the implementation and execution of the agreed action some high level politician will be appointed, which at the end will not have the time and the priorities to focus on exactly what the accord aims at, and so on. So there are many possible failures that can be built into agreements and can should be avoided. Now, let's look quickly into conflict analysis in the context of the water management. So first of all, this includes the identification of issues, then the identification of the actors, the parties. It should provide a history and a geographical distribution of the conflict. There should be an analysis and understanding of the level and intensity. There should be a list and analysis of the political, economic, social, and institutional structures. And the impact should be clearly understood and traced. Now, typical conflicting issues on water are about access to water. That access to water could be open or restricted, regulated, or closed. They also arise about spatial or temporal dependency on water. They arise around the purpose of access to water and the impact of this access on other groups. And who those groups are who are impacted on by this. And they arise around ownership of water. And there may be traditional rights or commons, might be a private or public legal frame for water. So such conflicting issues which should be analyzed are also the water use as such, the ways, quantities, frequency of the water resources use, and the impact of human activities on water resources. That could be effluent discharges, could be the use of chemicals, fertilizers, pesticides, herbicides, etc. It could be due to solid waste disposal, or it could even include dredging or canalization of rivers for various purposes. Now, also important is to identify the stakeholders dealing with management. This includes management and implementation policies, programs, the decisions which are in place, the frame to it, and it includes a stakeholder analysis that specifically should outline a description of the stakeholders, who are those people, the size, gender, values, needs, fears, their presence, representation within the river basin. And it should include access to water resources and control over water resources. Who out of this stakeholder list has access, when and how often, and who controls those water resources. Also, we should understand and map out the relationships between the stakeholders. Now, at this point, I want to conclude on conflict resolution. This was just a brief overview, and I suggest you to continue on the case that you picked from last time, the river basin. And compile a list of events in the order of occurrence, which eventually led to the current conflict situation, to conduct a conflict analysis as per the points that I just presented to you, try to differentiate between latent conflicts and open conflicts, and identify tipping points in the history of this conflict, at which point something got accelerated or got out of control or became much more apparent. And also identify points or moments in this pathway of conflicts at which the situation could have been de-escalated and how should the process have been guided. With this, we conclude for today, and I see you next time again.